keeping savings. And then we move into a section 1.3 on reserves and balances. We've already talked about that in some detail, but if there's any additional questions, we can take them now. If not, we can move on to the provision section. Again, if there's any questions, we can take them. Otherwise, we then move to debt write-offs and the detail of the sundry debts that have been written off. And that then takes us through to the capital programme. And do we have any questions on the capital programme? One of my concerns is that actually we don't spend enough time worrying about the capital programme. And it is, as you'll see later on, an intention to have a more detailed report on the progress on the capital programme, because I think it's very important that we do have a better understanding of the detail of what is going on. Councillor Levine.
Yeah, I was quite concerned about this section because every year we get massive slippage in. And in my view, you're only getting that if you total, eventually if everything was slipping, years will be balancing. But you're getting slippages every year, and that implies that the number of jobs that have developments in the system are increasing, and we've potentially got a big commitment there, which were it all come to fruition, we might be in trouble with. So again, I know that something is actually underway on this, but it does need a more strategic look at this whole area.
I completely agree with you, and that's why, as you'll see later on, we've actually put a separate section in the future reporting on the capital programme. And as you know, policy and resources are considering in the July meeting the profile of the capital programme in a lot of detail to make sure that some of those slippage issues are explicitly discussed by members.
I think it's not just slippages. I think we also need to look at estimated budgets for these things as well, because if you're borrowing money which you're then paying interest on, you need to know that it's actually
I think that is correct, although of course interestingly, the council hasn't actually borrowed on its general fund any more money. It's drawn down on its cash reserves so far because much of the money in relation to capital programmes comes from third parties. So I agree, we need a lot more discussion on that, and that is explicitly programmed in to the future programme of this committee and also policy and resources. And I think that you can see that in table 13 on page 29, where there is an analysis of where the money has come from in relation to the funding of the capital programme. And you will see that only 8.3 million out of 160 million was classed as borrowings, and in the footnote it indicates that this actually came from the drawdown on our cash holdings. And as a result, there's no interest charge resulting from that county treatment. So, moving on, that takes us to treasury management and prudential indicators, a notice of our investment performance and where our money is, which is, again, something which, between this committee and policy resources, we're responsible for looking at. The debt management, which, as noted, has not changed since last year, although you will have noticed from the accounts that one of the loans is now dropped to being repayable within 10 years, and that's only 22 million. The balance is over much longer periods. And that covers the text in the report, and then there are the individual tables for each of the theme committees, which will be being looked at by the theme committees, and similarly for the capital outturn by theme committees. I'm very happy if there are any questions to take them, or if there are, we will go to the recommendations on that report. Councillor Gray.
Thank you. Page 33, at the very bottom on HP Law. What are the implications about SLAs being put into place here? Which theme committee budgets would they have an impact on? In particular, would it be to do with legal costs around children's services?
Um, The other, sorry. One of the things that this committee will be looking at during this year is HV law and how that is working. And I think that what the those who are looking at this are trying to do is to make sure that there is an allocation of responsibility for legal services to those areas that are using them, so that there is an appropriate incentive for people who are using lawyers to think about what they're costing to decide whether they're being used effectively. Nothing in that change is going to affect the ability of children's services to continue on its improvement path or to fulfil, or adults to fulfil their statutory responsibility.
So we'll have additional funds allocated?
The fulfilment of their statutory responsibility is something that adults and children have been doing, and that is what has led to the budget pressures. So I think it's a question of allocating funds specifically, but in terms of controlling their costs, which is a lot of what adults and children are having to do, it's really important that if legal costs are an important component of that cost, that they are aware of what they're spending. And the purpose of this change is to make sure that they are, as with all components of costs. It's no different than any other cost. And it's a very small part of, I think, their combined £140, £150 million budget.
This was updated quite 3 years ago.
Right. I think that we've probably got this point where we put some recommendations on page 14. The committee is asked to note the General Fund Revenue Act as detailed in paragraphs 1.2 and appendix A. Is that agreed? People are happy to take the recommendations as read, just to note. You noted. Let's just move on. Right.
Has the David Football Club ever moved? Was relocated.
Is it nice?
There was David Football Club relocation. It's been there for years, and it didn't happen with it.
I would hope that is a bit of reprofiling. Reprofiling.
I don't
know.
Agenda item 8, future financial reporting. What we've done in agenda item 8 is to. The Section 151 officer has laid out what we believe is an appropriate structure for the financial reporting to this committee, explicitly looking at the revenue monitoring, the capital programme, obviously the importance of reserves, debtors, treasury as now. Then we think that probably at the council level we do need a sort of strategic financial matters and internal controls, as where they've been alluded to, are a major issue that have to be dealt with. And then, in terms of longer-term financial planning, making sure that the trend information and what is actually going on is actually linking in and giving credibility to the medium-term financial strategy and any cost or income generation, cost reduction or income generation programs. So that's the structure of the report that we are proposing, and I'm very happy to take any comments that people have. I don't know whether Section 151 officer would like to add any more details. I mean, I think that it is also worth noting to the points that were made earlier about the importance of having reasonably contemporaneous financial information, that we have identified in Section 1.3 which forecasts will be available to the committee at which date so that we can see what is going on. I know that there are those who believe that we could do more, but let us start with what we know that we can do.
To the audit committee, and
at a service level in very, very considerable detail. I commend to you the audit committee papers because I think that our audit, internal audit teams really very high class.
Chair, I think most members of this committee at one point or another served on the audit committee. I think every single one of us would probably commend to Councillor Bray that he ought to leave the papers or attend them because they're very interesting meetings. You really want to know what's going on. But the council, I strongly advise you to leave them.
I remember some years ago, Councillor Sandler claimed that we hadn't used six money and it had to be repaid. It might be useful if we could be told from time to time how much section 106 money there is and how much has to be used within a 12-month period.
What I would advise Councillor Marshall is that there is a report coming to the Audit Committee on the accounting of section 106 and silver money as we speak, and therefore it is on the agenda of the Audit Committee for the next meeting. Councillor Finn, as Chairman of the Audit Committee, will be considering this very carefully.
I think the suggestion was that we should get a report to this committee as well, which I agree with.
Well, can I suggest that in order to avoid the implication that we circulate to the members of this committee the audit report on this, so as to avoid duplication and officers being asked to do stuff that has already been done.
The audit report's a one-off. This is an ongoing report to this committee of the state of 106.
Yes, the 106 and sell money is probably the province. We'll talk to governors. I don't disagree that you should go to a committee.
Okay.
If it's not going to ARG and it's not going anywhere else, then yes, it should come here because we're there to sweep up anything.
Members may find it helpful under the proposed capital programme section. That will include a funding piece, and in there, section 106 still is a key funding element in the programme, so the board at least be an update in there on where we are with that. I hope it's been utilised to get the current scheme, so you might find that helpful.
And just to that point, if you turn back to page 29 and table 13, you will see that in that table on page 29, there was already a detail of the section 106 and other contributions. So we've already got that information in part in this report, but without much specific commentary. But I do agree it is an important thing.
Can I take
this away with governments to work out that it's been there somewhere, if not, it is a good thing. Right, in which case, can we take as, for the time being, the recommendation, which is that we accept the section 151 officers that propose for his report to this committee? Is that agree with you? Right, so we now move to performance of back office functions. And part of our remit is to consider those matters, and these are the sort of specific issues which will be coming to this committee. And in paragraph 3 on page 58, we have the proposed set of reports that will be coming to us. I have suggested to officers that we should look at agency spend first, because of the importance of that to achieving this year's cost savings. The issue of HB Law has been raised, and I am not completely comfortable that I understand how that all works, and therefore I thought a report on legal services would be of value to this committee for them to be looked at by members for a considerable period of time. We know that pensions reporting has been difficult. The reason that we put that in March is to give them a reasonable period to achieve the improvements that are required, but we need to check that those improvements actually are happening and have been successfully implemented. And clearly, major programmes including benefit realisation is very important, but again, we put that in for the March meeting.
Mr. Chair, I just wanted to clarify, we're doing pensions administration under C as opposed to fund.
to the members' items that we discussed earlier. Councillor Brain, what's your response?
It's possible to have a list of everything that's considered back office functions and how it might be broken down so we can look at them. I can see a scenario where I suggest something being put forward to this and being told it's going to the wrong place, which happens all the time in this committee.
The answer is that's a perfectly reasonable request and we will accommodate.
One of the issues that bothers me is we look at things like agency spend as an item to see how we earn on agency spend. But will we also be able to look at the effect of having that as one of the targets, the effect that that has on other behaviour? For example, with the bin collections, with the food bin collections, one of the benefits of not collecting the food bin waste was suggested to be that the staff who were doing it could be transferred to other activities which would allow the reduction in agency spend in that area. So it looks like by asking for a reduction in agency spend, people are looking at how can they do that, and perhaps the things that they're suggesting may not be optimal for our residents. So there are knock-ons. It's not just looking at are we achieving cuts in agency spend, but what is the effect of having that as one of the targets had on the quality of the service overall?
I think that we are in a complicated world because it is undoubtedly the case that if you reduce expenditure, then at some level services will inevitably be affected. But the point has been made by Mr. Dix eloquently in the previous PCM meeting and now at this meeting, that if the council doesn't get a grip on its expenditure, it is going to be in some difficulty. And one of the areas of variable spend which it is possible for the council to get a grip on is the agency spend. And therefore, from the perspective of the financial performance of the council as a whole, it is extremely important that we understand what is happening to agency spend and that to the extent that it is possible to do so, that that agency spend is being controlled in a way that it should be. The thing committees, at an individual level, are going to have to consider in terms of the way this is then reflected back to them, because the decision to stop the collection of food waste was a decision that went to the Environment Committee, was debated by the Environment Committee and voted on by the Environment Committee as being something that the Environment Committee wished to do to control their costs. And so if there are changes in service provision, those changes in service provision will have to be considered by the individual thing committees. So I would expect that those changes, if there are such changes, will be considered by those committees, as the one you alluded to was dealt with by the Environment Committee. But the role of this committee, very explicitly, is to consider whether the trend information in terms of the overall council finances is satisfactory or not. What I would suggest, if it's acceptable to you, is let's get the report in September, which is not accepted date. I'm afraid we have to move because we'll come to that later, but we've got the wrong date in September. But when we look at the report in September, let's consider what the report says, and that if you believe that there are other areas that we need to look at as well, then we can debate that at the time, and we will try and come to an accommodation in relation to that, if that's okay as a report. Thank you. So, that's the forward programme. We will provide Councillor Wayne and all the other committees members with the list of back office services. We can debate next time whether there's any change to prioritisation as a result of what we should do. I would ask that we agree the approach and forward work programme for the committee in this area of interactivity that's acceptable for us. Thank you. Right, so that takes us to the end of the year contract performance reports for the major contracts, and I suggest that we take those one by one, and I will take questions first of all in relation to the Barnet Group.
Councillor Mitchell.
Thank you, Chair. I was just a little bit concerned to read on page 63 under 1.3 that there's an issue with the percentage of scheduled fire risk assessments being completed in the period. I don't know that we've got any officers here who can specifically answer that, but I think this committee really ought to find an answer. I think
the answer is Councillor Wright may be able to give us further information on that.
And I want to be very careful because I think the point that Councillor Mitchell has raised is an important one, and I'm saying this from memory, so it's very, very guarded what I'm saying. But I think all the fire risk assessments have been completed, and it was a technical reason why they weren't completed, and I think that was simply because of an access problem, and as a consequence, the reporting period that needed to show when there was a fixed cut-off date for the reporting period, and that fell over a weekend when the fire risk assessments couldn't get into certain buildings. But my memory is that straight after that reporting period, the fire risk assessments were completed, but the officers would want to confirm that.
I think exactly that. I think given the sensitivity of this issue, I think it would be helpful if you have confirmation that this particular issue has in fact been resolved. I think we can do that fairly rapidly. And also, we just need to check that the Housing Committee is also on top of this issue.
The additional detail that went to PNR quite recently confirmed that all the fire risk assessments have been completed.
I think it would be helpful for this committee in future, if when we're doing this section of the report, to the extent that issues have been closed off and the reports have gone to other committees, we try and cross-reference that to avoid this sort of debate, which, to be honest, none of us are necessarily experts in these areas, but we can be alarmed quite appropriately by comments like that. Councillor Marshall.
It might be useful to say when the Granville Road work is going to start, because it would be an indication that Barnton's getting on top of actually replacing
the Granville Road work has already started, and in fact two complete sides of one of the towers have already been done.
You see, this brings up the point you've just made, because you read this first paragraph, it gives the impression that there was design works being undertaken. And in fact, what you're telling me is the work has been undertaken.
I mean, we always have this problem when we're reporting backwards as to what extent we should put in a sort of post-report events section. And we may need to think about that so that for things that when we go through we identify as being of probable interest to members of the committee, maybe we'll do just a section at the end of the report with post-report updates so that we can include things like the fire risk assessments were completed. The Granville Road programme has actually started. I will discuss that with officers if people find it helpful. Councillor Green.
Just a couple of quick comments. One is there any chance we're going to get some of this 17.5 million back from the government?
The answer is, I believe that we have hope of getting some of it back. I think that the Housing Committee would expect to receive a report on that. If and when they do receive a report, I will ask that be circulated to members of this committee.
I think it would be really helpful if, like in 1.3, it could just be a little note saying Housing Committee, so that we know. We don't have to delve into it.
I agree. We'll look at this, look at that insight for the next meeting. So, that was the Barnet Group. We then moved to Cambridge Education.
So, there's more
educators out there.
Again,
I think this matter probably has been picked up by ourselves. But in 1.6, I noticed that a lot of the children who we've not met, the former syndicators haven't been met,
our disadvantaged children or children that have needs, and we should be particularly concerned about that group of children. But I think I've read some of the cells has already picked
that up. Okay. Yes, I believe you're right. I think that this sort of illustrates the difficulty of looking at some of these. I mean, the reason that these are here is because of the, they are major contracts of the council, and therefore it's right to present them here as a major contract of the council. But I think I am going to have to engage with the chairman of CELS to try and work out what he's doing, what we're doing, to make sure that we don't get duplication, and that somehow we pick up the issues, and maybe we can signal them by colour or something, where we know that these are issues which are being actively dealt with by CELS, so that this committee knows that they're not issues of concern, and we're trying to take a sort of broader overview of them, if that's the way it would. That's the point of clarity to you too.
Particularly with both Barnet Group and Cambridge Education, they have their own state committees which are looking at those policy agendas, whereas with the capital contracts, CSG in particular, there is no one committee which is looking at that, so I think that might be somewhat of a guide. But I think, as we said, the chair said at the start of this meeting, we have to feel our way a little bit on this to try and get the accountability to our critique from the DOD commissioner was about getting accountability to our. So I think this has been helpful in identifying an area we need to be clearer, so we will take that away from the chair.
Which takes us to CSG.
Can I just start off by making a comment on page 69 under the corporate programmes? And I have some very real concerns about the state of the Darling Road Community Centre and progress towards opening that and using it. Whilst the building work seemed to finally be getting underway, I would like to get some assurance that the arrangements and the management of the building will be ready in time for it to open, because I think the worst thing that can happen, particularly in light of the commitments that this council has given Smiley Brum and East Community, I think the worst thing that can happen with this project is that the building ends up being finished, but it can't be occupied and used because of protracted management issues. So I just want to flag that up as something I have a lot of concerns of.
Given the specificity of that concern, can I suggest we take that away and consider how to respond to you? Because I don't believe that...
It's a comment. I don't particularly need a response. I've raised it many times before. I'm just going to take the attention of this committee.
We'll take it away, and if appropriate, we'll come back to you, because I don't think it's reasonable that anybody would be expected to have specific expertise on that one project here. So, thank you. Anything else on CSG, Councillor Green?
I think under the customer service section, is committee or another committee that would be asking the questions of how are we going to make sure that we get correct information on the website in the future, and what happened with the government checks issue, how come that was incorrect, and what faith can we have in any future data that we're getting?
So yes, I think it's right for the previous committee to consider that, which is an issue with our contractual provider in terms of CSG, and it's also a back office function, as it were, so that if members would find it helpful to have that on a future agenda, I'm sure with the chair's permission we could work that in. We was considered the last PCM committee where we had a discussion with the head of the director from CSG came and gave us an update about the way in which he believed that happened in terms of the end of the course of the circle. But we can bring
it back. Incredible trouble with residents, I think it was loads of complaints.
I think there were one or two very specific issues which did, I agree, lead to a number of complaints, both from members and from the you know, the reality is that the web forms, despite the difficulties, are still going up. The point clearly is that people are going to get more confidence, they're going even faster, and this is a much more satisfactory and cost-effective way to communicate with the council if it really works.
But the governmatrix issue, last time we were all celebrating because we all got to know we were doing fantastic on the web, and now we find that we're not doing fantastic on the web after all. So what faith can we have in this data and how is it going to be right in
future? Yeah, but we identified that at the last meeting and have the schools corrected. This is just reflecting that as the MPD report. So can I ask what steps have been taken to correct it?
I think it would be helpful, Shannon, if we could bring back the members of say to advise on this.
So it's good to have a
yeah.
We did talk about it. We did say September should give them a chance to sort it out.
Yes.
We'll bring back to that. We take us to estates, finance, HR, information systems.
Definitely. Yes.